Right. So DNA, being so long and thin, needs detangling as it's processed. How do the detangling machines like topoisomerase work to manage this?
Well, okay, see, DNA is about 2 nanometers in diameter. It's very tiny because a million nanometers make up a millimeter, okay? Millimeter, okay, a million of those is a millionth is a nanometer, okay, so 2 nanometers in diameter. But if you laid out all the DNA in one of your cells end to end, it'll be about 2 meters. Or, yeah, 6.5 feet, as you would say. Okay, so very, very long and thin. It's double helix, so it's coiled up. There are two strands. Now, what happens if you try to pull apart a coil? The coil behind it's going to become super coiled and resist the taking it apart. Very quickly, you won't be able to take it apart anymore. And yet, when it comes to replicating or to decoding, you only get one strand at a time, which means you have to take it apart. So what every living thing has is a detangling machine. The fancy word is topoisomerase. One type is called gyrase, which is much easier to say. But what that has to do is it has to cut the DNA and maneuver it to remove a knot, to remove a coil, a super coil, and then it has to put it back together.
Yeah.
Because you've got to have it in one piece, okay? And every time DNA is being copied or decoded, you have to have these detanglers working at that time. Now, several problems for evolution. One is the irreducible complexity or the minimum functionality threshold. You've got to do 2-3 things, cut, maneuver, and put back. If it doesn't do all 3 things, it's worse than useless. Because imagine, first step, it's cutting, and then it chops the DNA to smithereens, and it's useless. Natural selection would go against it. The other thing is, because it's needed for reproduction, you can't even talk about natural selection yet. Okay. And another thing is, DNA encodes its own detangling machines, but unless you have detangling machines operating already, you couldn't decode that stretch of DNA to build a detangling machine unless you already have them there to begin with. So again, DNA has instructions for its own machines, including the detanglers.
If you're enjoying this interview so far, you might be interested to know that we also produce the world's most widely read magazine on the creation-evolution controversy, Creation Magazine. It's packed with beautifully illustrated articles showing how real science supports the Bible. It's designed for the whole family, and it is a great tool to strengthen your faith. Sign up now to receive 4 issues a year. Follow the link in the description. Now back to the interview. Well, it just brings to mind how difficult it is to detangle wires, cables.
Mm-hmm.
I have lots and lots of those in boxes, and every time I pull them out, it's going to take me several minutes just to detangle something pretty simple before a power cord.
Right.
And you're describing that these motors and the like are actually managing this with atomic level precision on a regular basis with great accuracy, disconnecting things, reconnecting things like an electrician along the way.
Except the electricians don't tend to chop the wires and splice them back, do they?
Right.
That's the one advantage of the detangling machines ourselves. They chop and then put it back. That makes it hard, though.
Yeah. So then elaborate on the implications of this for the theories on the origin of life.
Well, that the simplest living thing had to have the machines I've been describing. You had to have machines to error check, to preserve DNA from being broken apart, and to detangle, and far much more, because machines are needed to replicate. And again, DNA encodes instructions for its own replication. And as I said, natural selection can't be used to explain this, because natural selection presupposes that you've already got reproduction.
Okay. Well, then while we're thinking about the complexity of life, let's also throw antibiotics into the mix. How do different antibiotics work against this, disrupting these machines? And what does this tell us about the complexity of life?
Well, a lot of antibiotics work by targeting one type of machine in the bacteria, just one type of machine. And that seems to be enough to kill a germ, or at least to stop it from, it might actually just keep it from doing anything. Okay. It's a bacteriostatic. It means it stops it from doing anything, or bactericidal, which means it kills a thing. But for instance, the first motor we discussed, the ATP synthase, it's got two halves, an upper half and a lower half. The lower half is the electrical current. The upper half makes the ATP. But there's an antibiotic called oligomycin that binds the lower half, and they call that lower half the oligomycin binding fraction, or F0, FO for short. FO, it shouldn't be F0, FO for oligomycin, okay? And that's an antibiotic. There are other antibiotics like streptomycin, which binds the ribosome. The ribosome is the machine that decodes the protein into the amino acids, which we probably talk about, right?
Right.
But that's what the ribosome, the streptomycin does. And there are also macrolides and tetracyclics, which somehow stop the growing protein. So it stops proteins from growing, okay? Then you got things like the fluoroquinolone, or just the quinolones. What they do is they attack those detangling motors and stop it from putting the DNA back, which means they go through the bacteria's DNA, chop the smithereens, and don't put it back together again. So the bacterial genome is totally chopped to pieces. Okay. Other antibiotics are the famous penicillin, the best known antibiotic, penicillin, and similar things called cephalosporins. What they do is they just chop the cell wall, and if the cell wall isn't functional, the stuff leaks out and the cell basically bursts. So again, just targeting one part. But the thing is, it shows the bacteria need all these machines to survive. Losing just one of them is dead, which means the first living cell had to have all these machines to work.
Dr. Sarfati, this has been a great conversation looking at the sciences and the origins of life from evolution as well as the Bible. A lot of our listeners are probably interested in learning a lot more. So we have a free resource that we want to offer them. Can you tell us about that?
Well, thank you, Joseph. The resource is called Evolution's Achilles Heels. It's an award-winning documentary. It covers a huge range of topics. In fact, there are 15 PhD scientists. They're all speaking in their own field of expertise as to why evolution doesn't work. And the session most relevant to what we're talking about is on the origin of life. It discusses machinery, but there are also ones about natural selection, genetics, radioactive dating, Big Bang, the fossil record, and even why evolution matters for morality. For instance, how evolution was the basis of the Nazi Holocaust. And it's a very good teaching tool because it's 9-10 minute sections, so you can show it over several weeks, and it comes with a free study guide, so you can use it as a great teaching tool.
Excellent. If you want to watch the award-winning Evolution's Achilles Heels, you'll find a link to stream it for free in the description. Dr. Sarfati, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you, Joseph.